This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have a guest who is going to take us down deep into the UFO rabbit hole, which is a place I love to go, and I'm pretty sure you love to go there too, or you wouldn't be here. We are going to be exploring all sorts of things from Project Sign and Project Grudge to the truth about Kenneth Arnold, the first UFO sighting. There's some missing information that's very, very important. Our guest has been deeply involved in things like the Rockefeller Disclosure Project. He has had a lot of thoughts about the challenges that we're up against right now. And without further ado, I want to introduce him. Keith Thompson is with us. He is the author of the UFO Paradox, which is a big, complex, wonderful, super interesting book that covers the waterfront, actually. It really covers a lot of things. So welcome to Dreamland.
Well, it's great to be back in Dreamland, Whitley, and again, a chance to see you again. We've spent a little bit of time in person, and here we are again online. So what a pleasure.
Right. Yeah. The last time you were on, it was February of 2022 for, I believe, Angels and Aliens.
Is that yes. Yes. My first book was called Angels and Aliens, which is still available, but it's a used book. And I don't get any royalties from it. It's not in print anymore, but it was my first foray into this subject.
Okay, so let's go back. That's a good beginning to the UFO paradox. By the way, Keith's website is thompsonatlarge.com. That's thompsonatlarge.com. And let's go back to the beginning. You become interested, and it has something to do with J.L. and Hynek and the swamp gas explanation.
Exactly. Let me tell you that story. I've been at this a long time only because I got at it at a very young age. I was 12 years old when it was my turn to give a current events report in my sixth grade class. And I lived in Northwest Ohio, neighbor of the state of Michigan, which at the time was the site of a remarkable set of sightings near Hillsdale College. And it was multi-day UFO sightings, lights, objects, very credible, very compelling. And so I decided to report to follow this for a few days, knowing that it was my turn soon to come to class with clippings. And we could choose any story we wanted. I found this fascinating. I knew nothing about UFOs. My father was an airplane pilot. We were an aviation family in a hobbyist sense. So I did a lot of flying as a passenger, but never had thought about the UFO phenomenon. So J. Allen Hynek, as you know, the Air Force consultant, came in, flew into Michigan, and did an investigation. He went around to all the different sites, and finally, it's time to give a news conference in the old days. So he walked up to the front of the auditorium with the members of the press with their tape recorders ready to catch what he had to say. And he made an offhanded comment that he couldn't account for everything, but at least in one of the locations near the edge of town, near a mossy bog or a swamp, in that case alone, it might have been an instance of swamp gas, which is a real natural phenomenon in which decomposition of natural materials results in luminescence. He was mortified, Whitley, to watch the reporters jump up in the middle of his news conference, run outside to the bank of payphones, call in this report. Air Force dismisses sightings as swamp gas.
It's a famous story, and the question is, why would the media jump on it like that? And of course, he regretted it for the rest of his life. And they jumped on it because they were scared, and it was funny, and it turned a threatening situation into something you could laugh at. I think that's what
you did. You could laugh at, you could domesticate it. You've taken a wild wolf and you turn it into a domesticated chow chow, or whatever you want to call it. I mean, it's
maybe the most pleased of all would have been that wolf, who would have thought, ah, how convenient. Now I'm wearing a swamp gas coat instead of my actual wolf pelt. in swamp gas clothing.
Well, so he saw what had happened, and I reported on this in my report in class, and I simply said, this was a remarkable thing because this did not match what the people were reporting. So one of my classmates said, well, do you think it's aliens from outer space? And I even then thought that was a big jump. I knew that was an interpretation. I said, well, I don't know, but it certainly didn't resemble what the people reported. Did not resemble swamp gas. You know, the people of Michigan's response to this, we may be rural, but we're not rubes. We weren't born yesterday. And that was part of the joke. Let's make fun of the people of northern Michigan. But again, it wasn't Alan Hynek who was making fun. And it was not, he did not say all of these were swamp gas. But he was misunderstood, misquoted. And I got an experience through giving this presentation in class. One of my classmates said, well, then what do you think it was? And I said, well, I don't know either. And Whitley, that wasn't a punt. I was 12 years old. I didn't have a need to know, or I didn't have an overriding need to sound authoritative. But again, I emphasize, sure doesn't sound like swamp gas or the other all-purpose explanation, weather balloons, which was soon to come into the picture. So my teacher said, I think what Keith is saying, class, is it's important to keep an open mind and ask relevant questions. Well, I can tell you that had a defining experience on me.
You had a good teacher, Keith.
I had a good teacher because I felt seen. I came from a family where I was not outvoted. I wasn't shouted down. We were allowed to express our opinions and encouraged to. But I had never really had outside my family that kind of I called it a benediction later. I was like a blessing for an adult to look at me as an aspiring adult on my way to being an adult and said, you have something to contribute. You have something to say. And so I continued to pay attention to this phenomenon, especially this dynamic. Ordinary, credible, responsible people report incredible, remarkable, magical, if you will, phenomena. But they do it coherently. Then the
official dates, Keith, when was this? When were you?
This was 1966.
66. Okay. So, you're a little boy still. Darn it. Everybody's younger than I am until finally I have returned to from whence I came. Any case, well, you'll reach me. You will reach me and hopefully beat me one of these days. we have a situation where you have been engaged by something you've read. Did you ever have any UFO sightings or anything at that period in your life?
Never had. We did a lot of flying. I didn't even know to look for them. I never got a chance to ask my late father whether he had seen anything that seemed out of the ordinary. He did teach me to pay. I got a love of the open skies from my father. He'd say, Keith, you want to go for a plane ride? I had three brothers and we all took turns, but sometimes it goes as a group. But sometimes he'd say, Keith, want to go for a ride? Going to the airport. So I got to sit in the co-pilot seat of a two-engine plane, and he had some work to do usually. It was his business as well as something he did for fun. But I learned to pay attention to the open sky and to find the wonder and mystery, but never had any UFO experience. I have had, you know, I can't say I've never seen anything in the sky that was extraordinary because I had. And that is 2 years after this little report in school, I had a practice, a retreat that I would take. I would climb onto the top of our house roof, the roof of our house. We weren't allowed to do this. I'd go up the TV antenna. We had a fixed antenna built into the ground. You remember those kind? And it was like a ladder to the stars. So, you know, the song up on the roof, when this old world starts getting me down. So I would go to the roof and I'd lay down and I would find solitude and peace. And one day, age 14, while laying back on the roof with no aim or purpose in my mind, looking into the beautiful blue sky on probably a summer day, there was a moment of brilliant flashing through me. And I was suddenly everywhere at once, nowhere in particular, with a sense of something so extraordinarily right. And as if I had seen through the maze of things and was amazed at this sense of unbelievable, indescribable presence, stupendous presence.
I can still remember. We, Skeef, we have to take a break here. We take a couple of breaks in the first half hour, and we'll just take a break. We'll be right back, folks. And when we do get back, we're going to go deeper past the moment of realization that this is a bigger world that Keith has been so beautifully describing, into the mysteries of that bigger world. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
We're talking to Keith Thompson, his book, The UFO Paradox. ThompsonAtLarge.com is his website. And before we left for the break for the Free Dreamlanders, we were talking about a numinous experience, basically, of connection with what I suspect was probably conscious light from the sky, that it changed you deeply, obviously. And then but this is at the same time, this isn't a UFO experience, but it is maybe something that triggered something deep within you, because you became very interested in these, all of these questions about UFOs and so forth. What mythological literature, for example, and historical findings struck you, made this feel, got into under your skin?
Well, I'll get into that. Let me just finish just one detail on this. I climbed down from the roof that day, and I suddenly knew that this was a world, a universe, a cosmos of purpose and meaning, and that had to include myself, and that my life was meaningful in a way that I had never considered. And my family was not an overtly religious family. We went to church periodically, but it was more from the standpoint of good people. It's good for good people to be seen going to church, you know, for social reasons. I had no real orientation to religious teachings, but I came down from the roof that day and I said, I've been to center court. I've seen the heart of things. This is God country. This is what people talk about when they speak of God. At the same time, Whitley, because we didn't come from an overtly religious family, this wasn't something I was going to go into the house and tell my mom and dad, hey, guess what happened outside staring into the sky? No, it wasn't anything I was ashamed of. It was a sense of having known something deeper and that other people must be in on this too, a kind of secret knowledge. So with that in mind, I started to pay attention to spiritual literature. As I got older, I read Alan Watts, the great Christian Anglican who did so much in terms of popularizing the Eastern cultures of meditation and Buddhism, and read existentialist writers. And
yeah, so I know Alan Watts' work well, of course, and I'm sure a lot of our listeners do too. I want to ask you, though, to move on to the Kenneth Arnold sighting that you've got some quite interesting thoughts about. That like the swamp gas explanation, which the media leapt at, something went profoundly wrong with the Kenneth Arnold sighting. What was that?
Well, he was out looking for a downed plane in Boise, Idaho pilot, and suddenly saw out of his cockpit nine amazing objects flying in formation, which he later described as moving like saucers, as if they were skipping over water.
But not as saucers.
He didn't describe them as saucers. He didn't say they were shaped like saucers, but a reporter on the site, picked up the saucer image. So Arnold had described flying saucers, according to them. So flying saucers were seen. It's not to say that he described them as flying saucers and that's why they were seen, but it was the origin story, the creation myth of modern UFO sightings was the Arnold sighting, if you want to call it, an informal creation myth. And it established the paradigm. He actually described them as shaped like stingrays. So, of course, then history evolved. The flying saucer movement and UFO movement began. People began to report extraordinary sightings. That's one thing that his did, Whitley, which is to empower people to report on what they were seeing as well.
Right.
Interestingly, decades later, his daughter, Kim Arnold, came forward after father was gone and gave an interview. And this is what she told the reporter. She said, my father was always struck by how he was assumed to have reported mechanical hardware, high-tech stuff in the sky. It was nothing like that. My father said these objects were living and breathing and moved the way the human heart would move. And then here's something I know that you will relate to, Whitley. She said, my father believed they had something to do with another dimension. And the dimension is where we go after we leave this world. Is an otherworldly phenomenon. And of course, he didn't say that at the time. It was enough to report the objects moving like saucers. So yeah. In fact, imagine if he had stepped down from the cockpit and said, well, I've seen nine blue-white beings with various densities changing their shape and form, breathing like the human heart. He probably would have had to pass a psychiatric test to get his license renewed as a pilot. He kept that to himself. But imagine if that had been the creation story of UFO research instead. As you know, it does correspond to a continuing esoteric or spiritual, philosophical, eschatological is the word that theologians use, having to do with final things, deep mysteries of birth, death, transmigration of the soul. And of course, I remember so well, you're reporting so often, the day your late wife, Ann, came out of the office at home and said, Whitley, this has something to do with what we call death.
Yes, exactly.
This phenomenon that people are writing us about.
And we have so now the a situation. Arnold story, go ahead.
Yeah, the Arnold story is not gotten right.
We have a situation where first this is converted from, it becomes something, a flying saucer. Now, the thing that's fascinating about that, he obviously did not see flying saucers. He saw something else. But that doesn't mean that's all that's here, because I've got some video of UFOs, of flying saucers, that is excellent and real. I'm just making a note. I want that to show up in the show. And this video is of a flying saucer, clearly. So they are out there. But I think what he saw was many ways more remarkable because of his belief that it was something alive and that it had to do with the world of the dead. My wife, Anne, we have to take another break now. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much, as always, for staying with us through the break. And we're going to probably advertise some of my books. And why don't you go on Amazon and just do that, get some books, and maybe even subscribe to this website so you don't have to hear these anymore.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
We're talking to Keith Thompson. His book, The UFO Paradox, thompsonatlarge.com is his website. We have been talking about the creation of the UFO myth and the fact that it kind of went sideways from the beginning because of fear and laughter and confusion. But I want to move on now, if I can, to something that happened in Zimbabwe that you know a lot about, the aerial school sighting. I remember the morning that phone rang, and it was John Mack, and he says to me, "Whitley, I just found out about the most incredible UFO sighting in history." And he told me about the aerial school, and he said, "I'm going to Africa." And he went and called me back afterwards and said, "I have got incredible video of these people. This is the UFO sighting." So why don't you tell us about it?
Well, one morning in 1994, I'm pretty sure about that, at a school called the Aerial School, private school in Zimbabwe, the children were at recess. They saw a craft, an apparent craft, I use the word apparent because we really don't know what these are or what they seem to be or what they are wanting us to believe they are. But they certainly appear to be craft and creatures stepping outside. Now, in one sense, it had all the elements of a realistic event. This event, the craft seemed to be in space. It seemed to occupy a point in space consistent with geometry. It was seen throughout Zimbabwe that day. And at the same time, it had surreal effects. The creatures or the beings, aliens, if you want to call them, that stepped outside of the craft, and they would walk forward, and then they would walk backwards as if it was being replayed. They'd walk forward again and then walk backward in a kind of staccato step. A young girl named Emily Trim looked at the creature, and the creature looked back at her through deep black eyes, and there was a deep moment of knowing between the two. Let me just at this point pause and say, I look at the phenomenon in terms of Joseph Campbell's three stages of initiation: separation from ordinary reality, a vast middle range of betwixt and between, in which you're no longer who you used to be before the separation, and you're not yet who you will be when the journey is complete. Well, instantly, this young girl was suddenly now in the betwixt and between, in the marginal realms, a transition between who she used to be. It happens that her family was a Christian family. And even though this is widely seen by many other children and other reported throughout the community, her parents said, in effect, "Emily, these things don't happen. We're Christians. So we don't deal with this sort of thing. It didn't happen. You didn't see it. Things will get back to normal." That is so, as you know, consistent with the various ways in which the collective mind reasserts this is the way things really are. But she went through a long period in this marginal space, and only when she got a letter 25 years later, I should say, others in Zimbabwe said, "Hey, Emily, we're going to have a reunion to celebrate the school's 25th anniversary," I believe it was. "Would you like to come back?" And that, Whitley, was her calling. I use the theme calling throughout this book. I view the UFO phenomenon and similar phenomena as callings from the cosmos, as news from the universe, that there's more here. So she went back to Zimbabwe, met a local elder who said, "Come to visit me and we'll talk." And he said, "So you're struggling with this?" And she said, "Yes, my parents have told me not to talk about it." And he said, "Well, you must talk about it. The children have these things right. And you saw this as a child, and you haven't been doing well by not talking about it. It's time for you to come forward, and I give you whatever permission you need to do that." That was an extremely empowering moment for her, as I'm sure there was a similar moment for you when you had to wrestle with, do I come forward with this? Well, so I'll just pause at this point and see if there's anything we want to.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, it's a critical moment in a human life. It is an initiatory moment. You were speaking of initiation previously, and at the time, I found my experience so interesting. I had gotten past all of the fear and confusion by the time I started thinking about making public statements about it. And unfortunately, being me and being a little out of touch with sort of the mainstream, or at least I was, I don't think I am anymore, but I didn't realize that this had a lot of sort of social and cultural baggage connected with it. I thought it was just an interesting story, and Anne was thought I should write it out because she said it's certainly the most interesting thing I've ever heard happening to anyone. And we thought that Bud Hopkins thought it was maybe 50 people in the whole country that had this, or 100 maybe at most. We didn't know it was tens of thousands, none of us. And when the book, it felt like the book exploded in my face. So I know exactly where she was coming from. Now, there's something about, and I don't recall, I'm trying to think back on your book, on the UFO Paradox. Did you mention the fact that there was a very sacred area near there where the spirits of the dead are believed to reside?
I did say that. And as a matter of fact, when she went back for the, when young Emily, no longer young, she was 8 years old at the time. Now she's 20 something, and her life had not been going well by living with this secret and keeping it inside. She came back. And for the first time, when she came back to the school, they said, would you like to go see one of the local wisdom elders in the Aboriginal, the indigenous culture? She said, yes. And how have I not done that before? We were here as colonialists, in a sense. We never interacted with the local community, the local indigenous culture. So yes, she went back and she met with the local wisdom figure, the elder, and told her, you must come forward with this. But yes, it is related to those kind of geographic the burial grounds and so forth. But she never had that context with which to evaluate it. And the prevailing context was her family's Christian interpretation, and a kind of Christian interpretation that said, no go, we don't go there. This is not good. Right. It's not in the Bible, or whatever versions.
Well,
of that.
that's true of many people who work within the government on this, that we ignore this because you're supposed to ignore demons. And that's, I think, one of the reasons that so many of the records have been lost, because for example, the entire output of all records from the Roswell Army Air Field from 1947 to 1952 were apparently illegally destroyed. And as Congressman Steven Schiff found, and the motive behind that in part is a religious motive. Free Dreamlanders, we have come to the end of your time with us. And I would like to thank you as always for watching. And I do hope you come back next week. As always, also, this is going to be a good show next week, and Keith is doing a wonderful job today. His website is thompsonatlarge.com. You can engage with Keith there. The UFO Paradox is the new book. It is a deeply researched, very, very smart book that will open all kinds of doors in your mind and explore some tremendously interesting questions about so much more. I mean, we haven't even covered yet most of it. We've got still a lot to talk about. Robert Bigelow and the alien abduction question of the difference between the Bud Hopkins approach and the Dave Jacobs approach, the future of reality and what that means, and what is phenomenology as opposed to the scientific method. We've got loads to do. So subscribe to unknowncountry.com and you can listen to it all. Subscribers will keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.